Now, I want just briefly to talk about the beginnings of a few images from the beginning of shamanism. We have these images in the cave of Lascaux in the Dordogne area in France. We have those great prehistoric paintings on the cave walls from about 25 or 30,000 BC. The most recent one was found only about 30 miles away, only about 8 or 10 years ago. It's called the Chauvet Cave, and it is dated something like 50,000 BC. So these walls that have been painted by artists from the beginning of time, celebrating their lives, filled with mystery, the mystery of the animals that they lived with, that they lived because they were able to sustain themselves with hunting and so on. This is a wonderful prehistoric piece. This is from a cave in North Africa, and I think it's dated about 15,000 BC. It's an image in one of Joseph Campbell's books. This is a woman shaman, and the essence of the shamanic energy is that the shaman goes on journeys for the good of the people. So even when you're doing your creative work, you're doing it in isolation quite often, but you're doing it, it moves outside your own studio, outside your own ambiance, into, even if it's just your immediate family. It isn't something you do and then lock in a drawer. Art is ipso facto communication. It is communion. It is something that originates here and moves there. It is to be seen. We see it first, but the seeing is outside the work of art. And this is any work of art, whether it's a play or a music, or it originates in the individual and moves out into society. So here is, and so the shaman's work, it's the individual shaman who goes on the journey, but the shaman journeys in relationship to other people's needs, either a group of people, in ancient times it would have been the whole tribe, or individuals. So when I work with Manuel, he is moving into that altered reality to get information from me, from the spirit world. So here is and so all these little people running inside and overlapping transparently this woman shaman. It's fabulous because it's like she's running toward this energy, into this mystic other place to get information, and they are collectively, psychically moving along with her. This is a cave in Australia, three women shaman pouring out this bowl of red liquid. This woman has already activated the sacred marriage in her own body, a woman shaman, but wearing horns. The horns always representing, of course, the presence of the masculine spirit inside the woman, and vice versa. We speak of shamans flying or running. A beautiful Eskimo stone print. And shamans have spirit animals. In this case, the shaman spirit animal is obviously this great bird, literally lifting the shaman off his feet, her feet, and the idea of flying into an altered reality to receive information from the other worlds. Another beautiful yarn painting. Now that you've seen what a yarn painting looks like, you can even see, for instance, in this blue area, you can see all the loopity-loop-de-loops as the artist has laid down the variety of blues. And I think I said yesterday, when you get this white line in these shamanic and these huicho pieces, this represents a shamanic journey. So here is, they've come from their village over here. They've been up mountains and down into the valleys again. And the shaman has come with his or her own dogs. Obviously, it's an androgynous figure. And we know that the shaman has been here before, because look, here the shaman has been here at least once before, twice before. And the prayer sticks that she's left on the other two occasions are still dropping down their energies. And she's got more prayer sticks that she's going to bring. And the name of this image is marvelous. This is called the Wolf Shaman Visiting the House of Wolf. So the most important identity that the shaman has is what animal, what spirit animal does he work in under whose aegis does the shaman work? The wolf shaman going to visit the house of wolf. Isn't this fabulous? And another beautiful, some reason the slide is tilted. This is grandfather. Yesterday we saw grandmother water. I guess the first day we saw grandmother water. This is grandfather fire. The shamanic experience is always associated with fire. Fire of heat, of breakthrough, of growth, of the heat that cracks open seeds, cracks open stones, the fire that heats and devours the dross to get to the fiery center of the center of realities. Now I want to talk specifically a little about a few of my own images. This is a painting from sometime in the 80s, so it's at least 20 years old. And this represents me as Artemis. Artemis is one of my spirit guides and represents me as Artemis with my feet in the Rio Grande. This is a cottonwood grove, one of the cottonwoods along the Rio Grande. These, at the time, were my spirit animals. For many, many years, the turtle was one of my main guides. And but in my own life, I find that my spirit animals come and go. They stay around for sometimes a long time, sometimes not very long. They disappear. Sometimes they come back. Sometimes they never come back. Turtle was around for a long time and has never come back. I call this painting Sacred Hearts. And each of these red blobs, so to speak, represents one of my animal's sacred hearts. The mountain lion also has disappeared from my life. The badger has been with me forever, as has wolf, as has fox, as has owl. The bear comes and goes. So this is me as Artemis with my divine animals, with my feet in the flowing river of life, which is really my book, The Litany of the Great River, is a book in praise of my life here near the Rio Grande, where I was daily, sometimes twice a day, with my four dogs. This again is a painting from the possibly the 90s. Again, I can't remember exactly. Again, an image of me as Artemis. This is one of my spirit rugs. It's a Navajo rug that I've had since the 1960s when I first lived in Albuquerque. And the whole time I was away, these sacred objects were rolled up and taken care of by my sister in Milwaukee in her attic. This rug, which you'll see this afternoon, I've always understood as the four red mountains, the four sacred mountains of the peoples in this land. This is Madra, my second dog, the Erdemir's mate, who came and settled in the composition. This painting actually started from the bottom up. They sometimes do. First of all, the rug was here, and then these legs appeared, and I never know. I only get this information piece by piece. The painting developed from the bottom up, and at a certain point, I realized it was Artemis. And as the painting evolved, one of the last things to appear, what happened was you have to imagine that this snake was not here, nor were these eggs. It's just that my belly started expanding, and these eggs appeared inside me. And then this red energy started appearing, and I thought, I let it just move around the eggs, and I thought it was like a uterine lining, like the sac that the eggs were inside. But then it swung round, and I thought, oh my God, this is a tail. And just about the time I thought this is a tail, this energy moved forward. this fabulous phallic thrust, so that it became this fabulous manifestation of what I talked about this morning in the prayer circle, that we, in our sacred marriage with our masculine half as women, our daemon, our holy union, holy, H-O-L-Y, that the energy comes with the, like any energy, the meeting of the male-female polarities creates energy fire. And it's that is what the creative fire is, and that is what creative work is. This is why I feel strongly that all creative work comes out of at least some area of that shamanic energy. Anyway, this painting was also evolving in the studio when I was painting this, so that this is how the two paintings got inside each other. And my brushes are winged like feather, like arrows. This is a piece that I use ritually. It's, of course, a serpent. A painting from the 90s called Feeding Crow Mother. This is my fire altar, which you'll see this afternoon. And this represents the time of the year which is approaching now, when all of the crows come down. It's getting chillier now. The Albuquerque is, the altitude is anywhere from 4,500 feet, where you are right now, that's the river valley, up to, you might be living at 6,000 feet, 6,500 feet. So obviously the people who live in what we call the heights have an entirely different seasonal relationship with the landscape than we do down here in the valley. And it's cooler in the summer, and of course it's also colder in the winter. And the crows react to that. So it's warmer down here in the winter, and all the crows come back and live through the winter in the valley. And there are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of them. These cottonwoods surrounding all the cottonwoods here in this property will soon, of course, be dropping all of their leaves. And early in the morning, at dawn, these trees can be black with crows. So this is a huge, huge rhythm in my life. When the crows leave, when the crows return, it's a little bit traumatic for me because, of course, I'm going to be gone. I'm going to be in Spain when the crows return. So I'm a little bit traumatized by that. But still, it's you can't get everything right. The title of this painting is Feeding Crow Mother. I do feed the crows. I probably spend more money on dog food for the crows than I did on my dogs. But it's wonderful to give them food and, you know, bits of bread and whatever I think they would want to eat. I had for years not accepted invitations to do shamanic work, not in any kind of negative way, but only because I would say to myself, how is it that I would, I'm going to turn this off for a moment, how is it that I would go to someone and delegate, give them my authority to go on journeys for me, to talk to my animals whom I'm already in contact with? It never made sense to me because I knew that I'd been doing this for years. And it seemed to me an abrogation of my own identity, that I did this, and why involve anybody else, and et cetera, et cetera. From time to time, people would say, would you like to join us? This shaman is coming. And I would say, thanks very much. And I mean, I had nothing negative about it. It's just that I felt it was not what I was supposed to do. And then this was years ago now. Robert phoned one morning and said he had met a very interesting woman shaman, and she was coming to his home. He lived at the time in Old Town. And he had invited a few people to come, and please would I come? And I said, no, thanks very much. I don't want to do that. And that was fine. So. And then a little while later, some time went by and the phone rang. Meinrad, are you sure you don't want to come? I'm really kind of feeling you're supposed to be here tonight. And I would say something like, well, thanks very much, Robert. I don't have that particular feeling, but so I'm not going to come. So, ta-da-ta-da. And then time went by, the rest of the morning, whatever it was. And again, he phoned and said, I'm really feeling strongly you're supposed to be there. So then I had to stop and think, because that was the third knock. You know how fairy tales are filled with the three knock, the three knocks on the window, the, you know, by the white bear, and the three sticks, and the three ravens, etc., etc. So I thought, okay. So I said, hang on just a minute. Let me think. Let me be with this for a minute. So he stayed on the line, and I thought. I didn't think anything. I thought, well, okay, three knocks, yes, I'll answer. So then I said, yes, I'll be there. And the image I'm going to show you is the image I was given, one of the most powerful experiences of my life, which just as I'm telling you this story in detail, because this is, you must always be ready to relinquish your own power. If you really know, which in no way diminishes your energy or your power, but you've got to be able to know when the circumstances are providing you an entry into another place, which will take you to an even, just a different place. It's not that you need help, you're just going to get information in a different way. Now this story, and I'm going to again to tell you the story because it's, I'm going to tell it to you in detail. I dropped into the woman, I think some of the people there, possibly, maybe most of them, I can't remember now, had never done this. So she gave the very simple instruction about how, you know, it's, you know, the mind programming thing. I'm going to, the drum will sound this, when you hear this, go on your journey, when you hear this, come back from the journey, is basically what she was telling us. And you know, to go into a hole or someplace in your landscape. And but I, of course, I always enter my place inside. I'll show you this afternoon the hole that I enter. It's in the landscape of my own studio, so to speak. So I the drumming started. I entered, I fell into my hole. And when I came out of the hole, I was in a desert, which is where I very often end up, in simply a blank space, which is simply naked earth and naked sky. No clouds, no sun, no moon, no nothing. It isn't day. It is usually day, but it's a dim kind of day. And as I'm standing there, just being there, I see in a great, great distance an animal running toward me. I can't identify the animal. When the animal gets close enough, perhaps from here to maybe, you know, the window in the next room there, a little bit closer maybe. At a certain point, I realize it's a wolf. And when the wolf gets to about that place, the wolf stands up and I see that she's a huge female wolf in full milk. And she stands like this before me, and then she starts doing a round dance, not around me. She stays where she is. And all the time she's going around, and her tail is dragging on the ground, and she's like in praise of herself. She raises her arms like this. And I watch this. It's like this beatific vision. She's so beautiful. And I call out to her, your name is Wolf Milk. And she calls back to me, yes, my name is Wolf Milk. And then she drops down on all four legs again, and she turns around, and then she starts back the place she came from, and I knew I was supposed to follow. And I followed. I trotted along behind her, and we had some adventures along the way. I don't talk about them. I don't talk about anything I haven't painted, because there's always a possibility I will paint it. I have painted one of the images, but I don't have the slide, so I won't talk. I won't tell you about that. Anyway, like all of these journeys, it seemed to go on forever. And yet you seem to go nowhere. It's that divine paradox of moving inside static space somehow. And then suddenly, Wolf Milk vanishes. I'm aware of her suddenly turning, and then she's gone. And before me stands divine Anubis. And the great dog god, of course, from Egyptian mythology. The Egyptian iconography is to the knees, really, but this his kilt went all the way to the ground, and it was this beautiful white kilt, sort of diaphanous, and we gazed into each other's eyes, and the gazing went on and on and on for a long, long time, and it truly was this beatific vision, this exchange of seeing energy. And then suddenly he took me by the hand, and as soon as he took me by the hand, a river appeared right here, this vast river, and it was just right here where nothing had been. And he starts to lead me to step into it. It's just as we're stepping into it, I hear the drumming sound, which is the sound to return. And instantly I'm back in Robert's on Robert's floor. And I had known for a long time that I was supposed to go to Egypt, but I had no idea how to do it. There's no way I can do tours. And I just thought, how would I ever have the money, et cetera, et cetera. Shortly after that, I phoned a friend of mine who has a travel agency in California, and I said, Neil, I've got to go to Egypt. How do I do this? He said, well, so he just said, well, talk to me about it, what you want, et cetera. So I did, and told him the places that I would need to go to, but no tours, et cetera, et cetera. So he said, well, give me a few days. So he phoned back at some point and said, can I go with you? And I said, oh, God, that'd be great, fantastic. So, and I thought, well, you know, how better to go to with a tour guide, I mean, you know, so somebody who knows how to do hotels, et cetera, et cetera. So he said, okay, you write out everything you want to do and how long you think you want to be there, et cetera. So I got busy on that. And in the course of doing that, he phones again. Well, John wants to go. John is another friend of mine in California, whom they knew, of course, they knew each other. Is that okay with you? I said, sure, that's fine. And then my friend who lives in this house, Rosemary, hears about it, and she says, well, do you think I could go? So anyway, we ended up as a foursome, as four friends doing this. We had our own car, our own guide. We went where I said we were going to go. I mean, they didn't, you know, they just said, hey, you know, wherever you want to go, we'll go. It was fabulous. It was something over 3 weeks, and it was it's coming up to the 10th anniversary of that experience. So the story I'm telling you is 10 years old, and it's ever present. It's the one of the constant realities in my life. I have a number of dog energies I call the dog god. Manifests in many different ways. Wolf milk is one of these ways. So here is wolf milk. And this is one of the few paintings that I've kept. I keep paintings as long as the energy is still wants to be in the studio with me. And then I can sell them. It's like they release me at a certain point. So they release me so I can release them. So here is wolf milk, and it's called Wolf Milk Nursing. So here is my divine sustenance. These animal spirits are like wisdom figures to me. They outpour their beings in every way. They feed me in every way. They nourish me in every way. And again, I very often, as I say, wrap myself like I'm... It isn't so much half-clothed. It's like always in a place of emerging that I'm never wholly out of my cocoon. And in fact, that really is the way my life is, because as soon as I'm finished doing, being with you, for instance, then I go right back into my cocoon, into my solitude. Of course, it's a little different now because I'm on my way to Spain, but usually there are long periods between, you know, doing a session here or, you know, going somewhere else to teach. Because obviously most of my work is here in my studio. It isn't out and about doing this, much as I love to do this. Isn't she beautiful? This beautiful, fierce animal? My mother, she's my mother, and from whom I nurse and receive my energies. And this is coyote and wolf milk. And wolf milk is I'm traveling inside, or so to speak, inside wolf milk's presence, and we're on our way to Egypt. And this is us arriving, wolf milk and me, and we do obeisance to divine Anubis. And we're moving now to an entirely different story. This is an image I found in Greece, I think 4 years ago. And it's a very, very, the oldest image I know of Artemis, my divine Artemis. Remember I told you that she's associated with darkness, a dark face, and sometimes an entirely black body. And I love this image because she's almost taken on the visage of an animal. And the way her locks, so to speak, come down and encircle these beautiful black breasts. It's a piece at the shrine of Artemis called, outside a village called Vravrona. The shrine is called Braurona. It's in a car from Athens. It would be a couple of hours drive south and then turning almost due east. It's not far from the sea. She's about 8 or 9 inches high, and she's one of the great discoveries of my life. The year before my dismemberment, working with Manuel, I had a severe experience in my working with Manuel, and this is what happened. When I got to the place, I was it was completely black, and I was myself. I was human. But I was in some kind of, I was down in the ground someplace and I was digging. And I was digging slightly up, so I knew that I was moving toward, toward the top, whatever that meant. Digging, and it was very peaceful. I mean, I was very happy. It was a very blissful place. And then I was aware of a slight sound, and I couldn't figure out where the sound came from. But I turned around, decided I would go and investigate. And when I turned around and came out of, back out of the place where I had entered, back out of this hole I was making, had made, I entered a blackness which was even darker than the tunnel I had been in. And I'm aware of a presence, but I can't define anything. But this energy, this presence is an energy, and it takes hold of me, and there's a huge struggle, which in the beginning wasn't particularly, it wasn't terrifying or anything, but it was a struggle. And but then it got more and more intense, and then I realized that it was a real death struggle, and that this energy was testing me to the point of death. And like another dream I had when I slew the Great Mother, which I'll talk about later if we have time, I slay this energy. And in slaying it or defeating it, it vanishes. And I see a tiny, tiny bead of light on the ground or in this darkness. And I reach down and pick it up. And I put it in the palm of my hand, and it starts growing into a bead of light, which increases. And all the time that's happening, I'm beginning to feel terrible, terrible pain in my neck and shoulder. Really, just a heavy-duty discomfort. And it starts moving down my arms, down my arms, down my arms. And as it moves down, it becomes more and more filled with fiery, angry pain till it gets into my hands. And by the time it reaches my hands, it is so intense, I'm writhing in pain. I simply cannot stand it. This is all still happening in the dark. And then it reaches the very tips of my fingers, and it blows out the tips of my fingers. My fingers end up with holes in them. While this is happening, all this time I'm experiencing this pain traveling through my arms down into my fingers, I'm also aware that there's someone in back of me, and it's somebody with a bucket of paint and a paintbrush, and they are painting me just up and down my back, no particular pattern. And it's the opposite of the burning, because it's cool and it's wet and it's refreshing. And it's also very detached. I can't at all feel the source of this, who this person is, or what this energy is. Anyway, the energy finally blows out the my fingertips, and then I'm awake, and I look at myself, and I have become a badger. I have no human identity at all. I am a badger, and that's the experience. And it was a very, very powerful experience. It was, you know, I still think a lot about it. And this again was on the threshold of making a doing going on pilgrimage. Just as wolf milk preceded Egypt, this preceded Greece. I was going with Greece to Greece with two friends. It wasn't until I got to Vavrona and saw that image, that old image of Artemis, that I realized, oh my God. And I knew it as soon as I saw it. I mean, I was just in this small museum going from piece to piece. I didn't know any. I'd never been in this museum. I knew nothing about what was in it. But it's like I walked from here, from looking at these things in this case. I walked over here to look at the things in this case. And when I saw that image, I fell to my knees in front of it and thought and knew that that is who had painted me. And that's what this painting is. This is called Becoming Badger. Now, this is a good example of painting. So when this painting was happening, Coyote appeared, the dog god appeared. He never appeared in this story I just told you, nor did this badger Kachina. This is a badger Kachina whom you'll see in the studio this afternoon. So when this painting evolved, it was then I was able to bring her in as the instrument of my... She finished the identity, as I think she's the one who was painting my new identity. So this is me becoming Badger. This is another image based on the Vavrona experience. You can still see I'm fixated on this animal face. When we got off the bus in this village of Vavrona, there was a dog there to meet us. And that dog walked us away toward the sanctuary shrine. So I knew that was obviously a spirit dog. I mean, to meet us at the bus, I ask you, in a place we scarcely knew where we were. We were out in this little village. I don't know who this figure is. Very often, figures appear in my paintings, and they have a very specific energy, which I can't identify. Whoever this figure is, this figure is offering me, again, here I am in this kind of an embryonic, infantile form. This figure offers me to the dog god and to divine Artemis.